What's up, everybody, and welcome in to another edition of the Sitdown. As always, if you enjoy this video, please make sure you hit the like button and let me know what you think of today's interview in the comment section below. If you're new around here, you just haven't done it yet, or you're living under a rock seeing this video on YouTube for the first time, I don't know what you're waiting for. Hit that subscribe button below now so you never miss another Sitdown video. If you're currently listening on iTunes, Spotify, Google Pods, welcome in. Leave us a review and let us know what you think of the show. We always appreciate all your commentary. What's up, ladies and gentlemen? We're back for another episode of the show. This is episode 121, and I'm your host, Jeff Nadu. We got a great interview planned for you today. I've been really looking forward to doing this one. I've been trying to contact this guy off and on for a while, and I'm excited to talk to him. We'll get to it in just a second. Before we do that, I quickly just want to tell you about my bookie. Football is coming up. There's always a need. People want to gamble. They want to get involved and have some fun. Nowadays, you don't even need to be at the casino to do it. MyBookie's new and improved online casino is here and ready to change the game. You can dive into truly a realistic casino experience featuring the latest in slots, progressive jackpots, blackjack, roulette, sports, live dealer action. You can do it all from your home. You can take advantage of blackjack tournaments, weekly high-end games, and real cash rewards. You're going to get that Las Vegas experience right now. All you got to do is open your account. Your adventure opens right now at MyBookie Casino. Go to mybookie.ag, use promo code SITDOWN, all one word. That's promo code SITDOWN. You're going to get yourself a 50% deposit bonus. So you put up $500, they're going to give you $250 for free. You're also going to get a $10 casino chip. You're also going to get access to a revamped loyalty program that ensures you'll be showered with all those rewards, cash back, offers, free spins, and much more. The more play, the more you win. Play anytime, play anywhere. MyBookie Casino, mybookie.ag. Use promo code SITDOWN. Again, that's promo code SITDOWN. Be like me. Football season coming up. Make sure you get involved and place your bets. MyBookie. All right, guys, let's get into the episode today. It's not a mafia interview. At least I don't believe it is. But I don't think he's in the mafia. But he played one on one of the greatest television shows of all time. It's one of the best character actors ever. The great Joe Gannascoli joins us live. Joe, you and I have been talking recently. You're a good man. You played one of the most iconic characters on one of the most iconic television shows of all time. You have had all sorts of cool things that have happened in your life. You've been in movies, you've been in TV, and you're from Brooklyn. We're going to talk about it all. How you doing? Thank you for being here.
I'm doing great, Jeff. You're much too kind. But if you're not done, I'll wait. You can keep going on.
Well, you're what are you, a book? You're an author. You have created your own tomato sauce.
I'm like an actor. I'm a chef. I'm a degenerate gambler, which I fight. I'm fighting. I'm trying to go on the cure. But that's how we'll get into that. That's how I got to be an actor. But, you know, I like to stay busy. I'm very innovative, always looking to hustle, always thinking of ideas. And Sopranos have allowed me, opened up many doors. So some have worked out. A couple of haven't. Some I'm working on as we speak. You know, reaping the fruits of my labor. So that's where I'm at.
And you definitely, I think, unlike any character on the show, and we'll get into the show in a second for anyone that hasn't seen it, what you've played, you played something that no one played, and you definitely put yourself out there. I think that's what makes you a truly great actor. So we'll talk about that in a second, but this is our first time speaking to you. And I always like anytime we interview someone to kind of understand who you are. You're from Bay Ridge in Brooklyn.
Gravesend.
Gravesend, Bay Ridge, Gravesend, Brooklyn. Yeah.
I moved to Bay Ridge when I was 20. I grew up on Avenue and Lake Street, right by McDonald Avenue, right around the block from Joseph Avenue. Gravesend, went to BS 215, David A. Booty, Lafayette, and then moved to Bay Ridge.
What was your childhood like? What kind of people were your parents? Did they?
Hardworking mom, hardworking dad, always told me stay away from the corner. Those guys up to no good. They're not going to go far. But like, I don't think my brother and sister were like this, but you know, when you're the youngest, you know, you see it and you're impressed, you know, by the cars, the flash, the girls. So, but I mean, I did things, but I didn't get too far in deep.
So I always find interesting about people like yourself. I saw a video recently on iron workers that are from New York City. You know, why do they go and why do you go the way you did? And why do people like, I don't know, Tommy Patera go the way he did? Why do you think you went the way you did?
Well, listen, I'm not overly religious. You know what I mean? I believe in God. I pray to God. God has been on my shoulder, but I also made my own breaks. And I was smart enough to, you know, follow what I wanted to do, not taking it an easy way. Some people have that guidance. I mean, my parents weren't overbearing. You know, I still at 13, 14, snuck out in the middle of the night, used to take the car. You know, my father had a Electra deuce and a quarter. And it's a pretty big car to drive when you're like 13, 14. And then I started doing it during the day, putting garbage pails in the street to save the spot. I mean, taking it to Staten Island, you know, paying a toll. It's crazy. Thank God. I mean, a million things got to happen. So I always say angels on my shoulder. You know, I involved in different things that came that were on the street that you moved, so to speak. But
so you did things that people in Brooklyn do. You didn't do anything too bad. You had some fun as a kid, but you always kind of knew when to leave, when to go home. And you had some sort of ethics in your head that I don't want to be like a lot of people around here.
Yeah. I mean, I never handled guns. I was never involved in that. There were times we had fights. People, shots were thrown at us. Thank God nobody got hit. After our places, you know, 17, 18 years old, so many kids running up wrong place, wrong time. Good kids, you hear it all the time. I'm sure you know this. The two dirty cops, young kid, Casso had it mixed up. He's showing off his car to his uncle.
Nicky Guido, right?
Yeah, Nicky Guido. I mean, how does a mother get over that? Died brokenhearted. So that could have been me many a time, especially working in the city. When I was working my way up and cooking, going out, you know, after hours in the city.
Yeah.
You know, and it was, but I, you know, I never really crossed the line. So,
well,
what's that?
They always say, you know, nothing good happens after midnight.
Well, right. A lot of good things happened.
True. Good point. That's a good thing. They don't tell you about that. But
I was a ball player. I was at the gym. I was always, you know, working out. You know, a lot of hooking up after 12 o'clock. I got to be honest.
Yeah, they don't tell you about the good things that happen after midnight, but there are some bad things too.
Yeah, there are definitely some bad things. But again, I was lucky. Once I knew I wanted to cook, I wanted to be self-taught and revered, and not Italian food, not run-of-the-mill stuff, but, you know, I fell into the cooking of French. And that interests me because that was new. I knew Italian, but French is what interests me.
Was your mother a good cook?
She wasn't a bad cook. She was Sicilian, but we didn't make these big, elaborate dinners. She worked. She came home. She maybe made some broccoli rabe, some sausage. She made a good clam sauce with fresh clams. Christmas Eve was that.
Yeah.
Nothing, you know, macaronis on Sunday and Wednesday. Nothing out of the ordinary.
But you, when you wanted to become a cook, you decided, you know, you're not going to do that whole run-of-the-mill, just cooking sauce and all that kind of stuff. You're going to go into something else. You're going to learn how to cook French. That's pretty interesting.
Learn how to cook French, and I happened to have an opportunity to move to New Orleans when I was probably 21. And I wound up, now that's kind of like a big, you know, I remember hawking stuff just to buy an airline ticket. And Cajun food was the rage, early 80s, and wound up working at Commander's Palace, one of the preeminent restaurants in the country, and it was a great experience, and I came home around 24, 25, and got to be a chef of this very exclusive restaurant in Bay Ridge called Night Falls, which won architectural awards for the design. And it was a beautiful restaurant. It was the place to go on Fridays and Saturday nights, had weddings, and they specialized in American cuisine, which was the big rage back then. You know, Larry Forgione was the head of that, you know, Maine lobster and Pennsylvania Dutch dressing over warm spinach salad, you know, all these names. And it was interesting, you know. And the woman I actually started my first job in a restaurant doing prep with, years later, she became the chef of that restaurant. And I said, hey, I'm coming home. She goes, come here. I could use you. And I wound up replacing her. Life of a chef, day and night. I was obsessed. But that's my...
What I find interesting about what you're saying is you made so much different food, Cajun and, you know, American and French and Italian, all this different stuff. I'm curious about this because you're from Brooklyn. The restaurant business, as you know, a lot of mobsters in that world. You ever have any run-ins with those types of people?
I didn't have run-ins per se. Coming into the restaurant, there was some, you know, heavy hitters that came in. You know, Paul Castellano. Well, first of all, the silent partner in the restaurant was Joe Gambino, who was Carlo's son. It was Tommy. Joe was the middle, and the younger guy was Butch. And he wanted to bake, and he used to come on Sunday mornings in a white jumpsuit and bake morning glory muffins for brunch. And his brothers, his cousins from Dial Poetry, Paul's sons, he used to break his balls a little bit. You know, go, Joe, what are you doing down here with the white jumpsuit making muffins? And they were delicious. But he loved to do that. And Paul Castellano came in for lunch. I remember walking to the, you know, I had to get a good look. And Tommy Bellotta was there. I don't know who else, but probably the German, Joe the German, who liked me and used to throw me a hunch, you know, back in 84, 85. Joe Watts, the German. Yeah, Joe Watts, the German.
A lot of people don't realize, they think if he was Gotti's guy, but he was with Paul before that. Tell the story you told me. Joe Watts was Paul's guy. He was very subservient to Paul for years.
Yeah, yeah.
People don't know that. Can you tell me the story? I don't know if you want to talk about it publicly, of the guy that came into the restaurant was acting crazy one time.
Told me yesterday. So I was sitting at the bar after, you know, work and maybe having after, it was probably a Friday, Saturday night, and this lunatic comes coming in. I can't remember who it was, what it was about. All I know is he came in cursing and screaming. Nobody did anything. They let him rant. They stopped at the front desk. If you knew the layout of the restaurant, which you don't, and was threatening, and then nobody said anything, and he finally left. You know, another time,
and who Carmine, was that?
What's that?
Who was that that did that? You want to tell us?
Who was it?
Yeah.
For some reason, but I don't recall the voice, because if he was yelling and screaming in as Tommy Karate with that voice, which he had a very high pitched voice, I think someone would have giggled and they would have been bad.
I think you remember. I remember you telling me you thought maybe it possibly was Karate, but you don't know for sure.
I don't know for sure because he wasn't a big guy. He was just crazy. So, and that was a place that I grew up in. It was Avenue West. His bar was called, I'm sure you know his bar.
Yeah, something lounge. I forget.
Yeah, as is or like it is or
just us, I think.
Just us. Yeah, good. So anyway, another time, because we had a beautiful backyard with a huge copper waterfall. Guy comes in and he tells the owner, who's the front man, you know, a well-respected guy, friends with Ed Koch, tells him to take a vacation. And he goes, "Oh, I'm going to take a vacation." He goes, "Yeah, this guy was looking to muscle in, you know." And this guy, Al, he's a Syrian, makes a call. Joe comes in and has a talk with Carmine Lombardozzi,
the doctor.
And he goes, "Joe, I had no idea you were here." So that was that.
So, yeah, you have these kind of run-ins. You see these guys, they come in. But
yeah,
that's interesting. And that's something that, in Brooklyn, you just dealt with. Everyone dealt with it. But in 1983, I'm curious about this because I didn't know this about you. you were in a film called Money for Nothing, right? It's a story about Joey Coyle. And from what I've read, you got that job through Benicio Del Toro. Is that correct?
No, I met him on that film. So,
but he was like your big kind of connection, wasn't he, in a way?
He was later on.
He's a great actor. I love Benicio.
Benicio's phenomenal. Actually, I just did a party. A guy came in from L.A. for this party that, you know, I cook. And he's done his last three films. And, yeah. So another connection that's going to mean fucking nothing to me. But anyway. I got to be friends with the casting directors for this movie called Money for Nothing. True story about a guy who finds $1 million in the street.
Joey Coyle, right.
Joey Coyle. John Cusack plays Joey Coyle.
Yeah.
James Gandolfini's in it. Michael Rapaport. Benicio Del Toro. Murray Chaykin.
Philip Seymour Hoffman's in it, I believe.
Philip Seymour Hoffman. Lenny Venito. I mean, great actors, and the movie did nothing. But I weaseled my way into a role. It was a day play. They were shooting in Pittsburgh. Normally, they hire a guy in Pittsburgh. They're not going to fly a guy out that has one scene. But they liked me. And I remember getting into my room. I went, holy shit, I'm in Pittsburgh, about to do a movie. So I called up Michael Madsen, and I said, hey, Mike, my name is Joe. I got a role. And, you know, I was wondering if I could run some lines with you and maybe, you know, make some changes. And he said, meet me in the lounge, in the downstairs, in the lobby. And I gave my friend a name. He goes, I said, can we call my guy Charlie DeSalvo? And they named the character Charlie DeSalvo. And I played around, and the director was walking by, and I forget his name, Pedro, I don't know, Spanish guy, nice guy. He goes, hey, listen to this, what Joe wants to do. Is it all right? He goes, yeah, sure. And we shot that scene. It was great. It was me and Michael Madsen. And Madsen wound up coming to a premiere for one of the seasons. And he was sloshed, but he remembered. I said, do you remember? Because I remember the day you got that tattoo while we were in Pittsburgh. He had a Chinese thing. And he remembered, or so he said. So that was my first movie. And Benicio found me. I was working in a deli on Sunset Boulevard. Says, I'm going to write and direct a short film. I want you to be the lead. And we played undercover cops. It was me and Matthew McConaughey. And we stayed friends. And when I moved back to New York, he said, I'm coming to New York. I'm doing a couple of Abel Ferrara movies. I want to get you in. I said, oh, beautiful. And he got me in small roles. I don't even know if I'm credited. But the casting directors were from The Sopranos. They brought me in because they wanted to know who I was. And they said, do you have an agent? I said, no. Well, then they said, just check in with us every few months. See if we got something going on. Hence, the role I got was Gino in the bakery scene the first season.
That's what I wanted to – that was kind of my first question on your whole role in the show. Because you were one of the – I mean, there are a few people actually that play two roles. But you are most known for your role as that – this guy, Gino. You're this customer at the bakery and you're just kind of like a stand-in. So at that point, did they just kind of say you were just, this is your small role? How does it all work? How do you become like, did he think no one would notice or?
I'm not sure. I'm sure Georgianne Walken had a lot to do with that. She was a big fan of Benicio's and she saw something. And as one of my scenes in the diner with Johnny Cakes,
yep,
that she's a customer. I think it's the only time she was in. And, you know, listen, I am forever grateful, God, but made my own breaks. And thank God it changed my life, you know. So they brought me back as Vito. And I read. And a couple of seasons here and there. But before I want to get to that, let me tell you a quick story. Do we have time?
Of course.
So I get to LA. So I'm have this restaurant in Bay Ridge, making a ton of money, and I'm gambling like a fucking degenerate. You know, back in 89, 90, 500 a game, morning games or afternoon, 1 o'clock games, 4 o'clock games, you know, I'm up, down, 3, 4, 5,000 like that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a rough way to live.
And you're running a restaurant.
Running a restaurant. You know, my mood's changing. I'm miserable. I'm happy. I'm miserable.
Life of a gambler.
What's that?
It's a life of a gambler.
Life of gambling. And I, last game of the year. Now, it's not like this. It's 1990, right? 89, 90. Last game of the year. It's not like it is today. You watch any game, phone, yeah. Sports bars. You had Giants, Jets, Sunday night football. Giants were going into the playoffs, so they rest all their starters. They're playing the Patriots, favored by 12.5, Giants. Of course, they're resting their starters. Patriots kill them. That was 10,000. My guy says, Joe, you're down 10,000. You know, you handle it? I said, yeah, of course I can handle it. I said, I want the, it was Jets, somebody. I might have taken the Jets. And I doubled in a little more. So it's 25. Now I'm down 35. And he goes, Joe, this is no fucking joke. This is $35,000. You know, where you're a friend of ours. We know you. I said, look, I got the restaurant. I'm invested. I said, I want to put it all on the fucking Steelers. Steelers. Going to the playoffs, rest their fucking thing. Cody Carlson from the Oilers throws for 500 fucking yards. Destroys the Steelers. I'm down 70,000. I was almost like faint. Oh, my daughter's been listening to this. Bib. You should have told me you were there. Oh, well, you shouldn't have heard this. No, you weren't listening. Daddy was a bad boy. Anyway. All right. Go up, please.
Many years ago.
So, you know, we had three TVs on top of the bar. And people look at me, go, Joe, you're like white. You don't look so good. What's going on? I go, man, not that. I'm tired. I'm working. And I'm thinking to myself, I just lost a restaurant. I got to get the fuck out of here. I had to pay off my bookie. I was going out with this girl. I didn't even tell her. 3 days later, I was in L.A. Strained out my bookie. And I was in L.A. Well, I moved to L.A. Oh, very quick. I noticed it taking a long time, but it's like really
it's
germane to the story. Before that, like after Nightfalls, I worked in the city as a 73rd and Lex, Jack's, four hotels, four rooms, restaurant at the bottom. It was a boutique hotel. Oh, a chef's job is pretty cool, you know, and a waiter comes up to me and goes, hey, you're like, you know, a real character, you're a Brooklyn guy. I'm doing a play. I have a theater company called Juice Man. Why don't you come on audition? You play the Juice Man. The Juice Man loaned money to guys on the docks. I wound up getting the role, and I wound up doing it off Broadway. But it was fun. So I said, hey, this is fun. I like it. What should I do? He goes, well, why don't you go study? So I tried to study for about a year. This guy was a lunatic out of his mind, but I enjoyed watching him teach because he just had a thing about him. It was, you know, anything. It was like Meisner protege. His name was Bob Patterson. And it was very interesting watching him teach, but he threw me out, which was fine. And that time I was selling ice cream from a cart down on Wall Street. I was living like a fucking bohemian. So I said, fuck this. I'm getting back in the restaurant business and whatever. Anyway, I call him up and I said, Tim. And now he was actually going to be a priest. And he's very religious. He went to Villanova, Jesuit. He's like the best of the best, my man, Tim. And I was either going to go to Italy to cook or pursue the acting with Tim. I said, Tim, I just fucked up real bad. He goes, listen, I'm house sitting. Why don't you come with me and we'll figure it out. And that's what I did. Okay. I'm almost done. When you get to LA, you can't get work without an agent. You can't get an agent without work. Mm-hmm. So, I started doing these one act plays after about a year there, working in restaurants, living like a scumbag, you know, fucking house to house, trying to get, you know, it was horrible. And a guy, I did these one-act plays, and this young kid comes up to me and says, hey, I'm going to start my own agency. I'd like to represent you. I went, really? You're going to start your own agency? You want to represent me? And I'm thinking to myself, holy shit, I got a fucking agent. So I said, okay, when? He goes, I'm opening in a few weeks. I said, well, okay, great. So I'm fucking smoking cigarettes like an animal. Just drinking coffee by the gallon, saying, oh, I got a fucking agent. I got an agent. I got an agent. It's good. It's good. It's good. He lived in, he was working from his apartment in my neighborhood. The day comes and I go knock on the door and he's in a fucking bathrobe. He just wore his hair as a man. I go, the fuck, it's your first day of business. What are you doing? He goes, oh, well, you know, we, you know, Hollywood doesn't open till 10. He goes, your first fucking day. What are you doing? And I go, here are the breakdowns. Now, the breakdowns only agents can get. Eight breakdowns are what all the agents get, what the casting director is looking for. I need a guy that can ride a motorcycle. He's got three scenes, knows how to shoot a gun. I need a guy that, I don't know, plays sports. You know, he's going to be whatever. And everyone that... And they go, oh, my guys, that's the, and then a heavyset guy. I need a guy that, you know, knows who he's, whatever they're looking for, and a movie, right. And TV, and plays, and commercials. So I get the breakdowns, and I start going through with it. I go, hey, I'm right for this, I'm right for this, I'm right for this, I'm right for this. I go, submit my picture, submit my picture. I do this for 3 days, and he can't take it anymore. He goes, look, you're driving me nuts. I will call you if you get something. So I said, this fucking guy. So I started waking up at like 4 a.m, running to his house, getting the, because it's illegal for actors to get them, getting the breakdowns, running to Kinko's 24-hour, making copies. And then I brought him back to his house. Now I took him to my house and I started submitting my picture. And I gave it a few days and I started calling up. That's how I got money for nothing. I started calling up and I go, hey, my name is James Hoving. I represent Joe Gannascoli. I'd like to get him seen for this role in Money for Nothing, whatever. And they go, what's your name? I go, James Hoving. I'm out here on business. I found Joe. He's a theater actor. I know he'd be right for it. I know he'll do a good job. Please see him. And I kept at it and at it and at it. And I told my roommate, Tim, do not answer the phone. It's James Hoving and Associates. Don't answer the phone. It's going to be maybe a casting director. I started getting myself auditions. So that's my fucking start, how I got my SAG card.
So you got your first role through just pretending to be an agent and just
hitting I was actually phones. A manager.
Or yeah, manager, hitting the phones, and you hit on something finally. And then you, through that role, meet people.
And, right. Then- and so I met Benicio. I didn't even actually work with Benicio, but he saw the movie and saw me. Just from that little thing. So my roommate goes, this is fucking nuts. You're not going to. And all of a sudden, I started getting callbacks. And I was like, Tim, tell your agent to submit you for this. You're right for this. You're right for this. You're right. And so he's asking me then. James Hoving can make a call for me. I go, yeah. I looked at it as an acting challenge, you know, trying to convince people I was an agent.
What's so interesting, because a lot of your early roles, you know, Basquiat, you know, you're in these different films. And all of them feature Benicio, weirdly enough.
So, true that. Julian Schnabel in Basquiat. Yeah. Never talked to strangers, no, but I house sat the producer. So he got me in that. That was with the girl was hot.
He was in The Funeral. You were in that.
The Funeral. Yeah. Correct.
I mean, let me ask you about Mickey Blue Eyes, because how about that? How'd you get that role?
I don't even remember how I got it. All I know is.
Because there's a lot of Sopranos guys.
There is. So they had shot the movie. The director had moved on, and Liz Hurley was producing it. And Hugh Grant was going to direct this. And I don't know how he got me. Maybe I was working with an agent, and he said he wants to see you. And I went to his apartment or his hotel room. And Elizabeth fucking Hurley with a long white dress, the sun, Sunday morning sun. I could hardly concentrate. I go, holy Christ, look at Liz Hurley. I mean, this is... I don't even remember what it is, but she was at her peak. And Hugh Grant was great. And we worked it out, and we shot it for a couple of days, and I got the role. They added that in. They added that in.
So 1999 comes. You hear about the show Sopranos. Let me ask you.
97.
Yes. Okay, so that's the pre-production. So when the show starts... You know, you're this guy, Gino, and I'm going to put that up on the screen. This is your character. You have a few words. You're dealing with Christopher as he's off the rocker. I believe that was in an episode called The Legend of Tennessee Multisante. That was
correct.
What did you think of the show? Like, what was the thought of the show at that point? Did you think it would have any success?
Okay, so this is season one. 97. I had no idea. Listen, Georgianne Walken says, we want you to come in for this role. I said, you know, Georgianne, I really don't want to do TV. I just want to see the film, you know? Wow. She goes, are you fucking kidding me? You don't even have an agent. You better come in and do this because this is going to be great.
You were not going to originally be Gino? You were going to...
I was like saying, because I was leaving for Michigan the next day. And I had to... Or I think I was shooting maybe Mickey Blue Eyes the next day. Mm-hmm. And then I was leaving for Michigan. And I said, you know, I'm running for here. And then I'm going to miss my flight. And then I got Mickey Blue Eyes. Wow. And she said, you make sure you do this. She really looked out for me. She's the best. And I wound up doing it. And not knowing, you know, what was going to be. I had met, I had done a film called, and that's all coming back to me, On the Run, with John Ventimiglia and Michael Imperioli. Mm-hmm. And they said, hey, you'd be really right for this role. You'd be really right for the show. Get someone to get in there. And that's when I called up the casting directors. That's what happened.
Gotcha. So you do the Gino thing, and then you get called back, and they say, hey, we'd like to put you in as a role of Vito Spatafore. And you're in Ralph's crew, and you... By the way, let me ask you, when you look back on the... And spoilers are going to come. So if you've never seen the show and you don't want spoilers, I don't know what you're doing. You're living under a fucking rock. You've not seen Sopranos. That's not our problem at this point. So in season, what was it, 3, you kill Jackie Jr.
Correct.
You have to admit, it's one of the worst kill scenes of all time.
I go,
blood's already on the snow before he hits the snow.
I go, where the fuck did I come out of that he didn't see me? And, you know, David Chase had a very diabolical sort of sense of humor. I go, and this time I have bad hips by then, you know?
Yeah.
And I go, what the fuck is up with this car? I can't get, this guy's pulling away. I can't even get in the fucking car.
You have the littlest gun of all time as
well. Yeah. And I just appear out of nowhere. And it's boom, boom. You see him hit this, I go, what is it? A fucking redwood I was behind or... You know, a school I came out of, but boom, and it was quick. So what am I? He directed that. You know, who am I that fucking I'm thinking of myself?
I mean, it's so funny, though. And by the way, then they have the subsequent funeral for Jackie Jr. And Jackie's sister references that.
Yeah, fat fucking see-through socks.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was always inside. It was very good stuff. It was good stuff.
It's such a well-written show, but. So you're in a crew where you just happen to be in a crew where everyone dies, right? So Gigi, Ralph, and you become, you kind of get a bigger role in the show, like towards 4 or 5.
You know, I just saw that today, that scene where my brother gets beat up at the golf club. And Gigi's the captain. And
Ryan's
you know, he's in charge for 5 minutes and he's fucking Lee Iacocca. That's what Ralphie says. You know, that was my brother, and you know, I just want him to bleed from his ass.
Do you, when you get the kind of the word that you're gonna have, do they say to you, hey, you're gonna get a larger role now?
No, you never know, what's going on.
Well, were you excited when you found out? That show's a big thing by this point.
So, you know, Wall Street guys are very on top of shit, and by then. 1, 2, 3, 4, they're like, oh, the fucking Sopranos is the shit, you know? So by season 8, I'm watching season 8. I'm like, holy shit, I'm in something fucking pretty cool. And not knowing anything, and all of a sudden, they call me for fucking Vito, which was cool. And I had some scenes in there, you know, I built a ramp for Beansy. And I was really big by then.
Yeah, you were beginning to be a construction tycoon by that
point. Right. Yeah, I've been meaning big in size. I was like really a fat fuck. And I had to do something, so I went for the band. Well, that's later on. I think I did that.
I'm going to ask you about that. Hey, Joe, don't rush me here. I got to ask you about it.
So it's season 2. Season 3 was pretty cool. I watched it in the restaurant. I said, come on, season finale. And I knew I killed Jackie Jr. And that was big. And at that time, I had a soup restaurant. All the actors were coming to the restaurant and meeting fans, and it was pretty cool. You know,
those are probably awesome times, like in the early 2000s, mid 2000s. So you just become more and more formidable as a character as this show goes on. I want to ask you about like guys like James and Tony and some of the actors you worked with that are no longer with us. And then I kind of want to ask you a little bit about Vito. What's it like working with guys? Because we've heard stories about Tony or James Gandolfini, how he was just such a nice guy, you know.
You know, I didn't have a lot to do with him in my scenes.
Yeah.
You know, I heard everything. You know, you want to stay in clear. He's, you know, you don't want to ask him stupid questions. You don't want to like, you know, how's it going? You know, you stay clear of him, you know. He's got his method. He's got his thing. He's got a little ton of shit. He's not really might venture out to the get something to nosh on. But he's alone, you know, working on his shit in his trailer. So, and, you know, there's all the extras that want to take a picture with him and ask him questions. They go, hey, Tony or Jimmy, you know. So I was always cognizant of that. But he was, after watching, you know, him work. Now, I had known about him in when I was living in L.A., and there was this manager. I was in his office, and he was trying to talk to Jimmy about this movie, probably True Romance or Natural Born Killers. I forgot which one. And this guy was an out-of-his-mind manager. I don't even know if he's still alive. He was, you know, doing crack, and the manager was. And trying to talk to Jimmy, he had me on speaker. I'm going, well, why the fuck am I here? I mean, this is like, you know, big. I didn't know Jimmy at the time. Another little tidbit is that I was working in a restaurant in that one where my friend said, hey, I'm doing this play. The chef was a guy named Herb, and he worked with Jimmy at another restaurant. Jimmy was a bartender. So we had that connection, which I told him. I said, hey, we both know the chef, Herb Wilson, and I was friends with Herb because, you know, he's one of my first chefs I worked for. But anyway, I forgot where I'm telling you all this, but he was the best, Jimmy. He was down to earth, regular guy, Jersey guy, super fucking talented. But you know, he had a lot of pressure on him.
Of course, yeah, we definitely learned that. Did I want to ask you about playing a mobster? Did that come real natural to you? Was that just something
you know
people doing?
You growing up?
Yeah, it's just it's
a you know you see how these guys talk, how they fight. How they act. Some of it's like really fucking like dumb. And you go, oh my God, what a fucking moron. Some of it's kind of funny, you know. But, you know, so you know how to mannerisms and speech is kind of to make it authentic, you know. You know. Well,
but I think nowadays, Joe, like, and you and I have talked about this, like, I'm not going to say the shows, but like no show is able to master. Like a lot of these shows about mobsters are very cringy and like corny. The Sopranos did a great job of just like understanding the authenticity of those people, right?
Whenever I read something and I see something like Capiche, I go, uh-oh, bad. Nobody fucking says that. And I say it to these guys that were haircutters where I lived. And, I always would talk to them and I go, Magavid. And I go, Achagavid. You know, it's slangy. And that's really is like, you know, I don't
like,
know.
No Italian actually says capiche ever, really.
Yeah, I know. I mean, you got to be like.
It's ever it means, yeah, or like, capito, like.
Yeah, Margarita. Yeah. And when one leaves, you don't even have to go like, Gabi, like, you just shake your head. You know what I mean? Or another thing, like. You see a guy. What are we doing?
Yeah.
You know? Right. What are we doing? We're leaving? We're staying? What? You know, things like that. So, you know, I think the funeral, when I say to Bacala, Marvin Gaye's own nephew, I go, you know, like that. Where the fuck were you that night? You know?
Yeah, you had some great like moments. One moment I want to ask you about, and then we'll get into Vito's, you know, kind of, you know, discovery and what happens to him. One of the funniest scenes you have is when you're called a parade float by Christopher. When you read that, when you read the dialogue, did you, you had a laugh, right? I mean, that was.
Yeah, it's fucking, you know, a little embarrassing. You know, I'm a captain. Yeah.
And you get a hoagie thrown at you.
Yeah. And well, a hero.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, and, you know, and I tell him, and it's funny, I stick my finger out. With my middle finger, not my, you know, my middle finger. And I got that from my friend Louie, who was working in the meat market for his uncle. Uncle was the guy. And the bandsaw cut his fucking finger.
His pointed finger.
Mm-hmm. So anytime, and he was a tough fuck. And anytime there was a problem, he'd fucking point somebody with his middle finger. I always fucking remembered that.
I often noticed that. I don't ever remember them. I always thought it was the regular figure. What was your favorite scene that you remember filming?
When Finn comes out of the porta potty. I love that. I did probably working. I was the only one with in a monologue. I was soaring. You know, handling a hammer. I'm not really a fucking carpenter.
I'm going to ask you about that.
You know, and I could tell when someone works in a kitchen how they handle a knife. Anybody's a cop and they go, oh, this fucking guy never fucking had
it. Tell you it was very new to you for sure.
You know, and you got to keep fucking hitting it take after take after take. And it's like, fucking my, you know, my forearm's getting numb. But we got through it.
So you're kind of most known for in the show. You've had so many different scenes and things, but you're most known for your roles in the late season when you are outed as a homosexual or bisexual, something like that. Now, you know, we would make this clear. You're not homosexual in your real life. You played a character.
Well, I am in a sense. I'm a lesbian.
You're a what?
A lesbian.
Okay. You like women.
There you go. You're fucking sharp there, Jeffy.
So... what I want to ask you.
No, I got what they call the twat tumor. I love fucking women. And I've always have. And just one of those things growing up in Brooklyn with the guys I hung out with. They were always fucking on the make for girls. Always. Where are we going? Let's go out. Who's this girl? I got to meet this girl. She got a friend. Hook me up. This and that. I mean, that's just the way it was. Now it's fucking internet and afraid to talk. But it's like... go to the beach. I mean, it's just a different ballgame. We were four fucking horns. You know, we were, I want to say good looking, but we were good looking. We fucking went out and we did all right.
So you get this role as now that's going to change. You're going to be a mobster who's making a ton of money as an earner. You're a big contractor, you know, boss. You're a capo. You have your own crew. You're you know, related through marriage to New York. You have a very formidable standing. You just lose a bunch of weight. Everything's good for you. You go to Johnny Sack's daughter, Allegra's wedding. You can tell there's something off with you. You then, that episode, are discovered at a gay bar. And you're dancing with this
character. So how did that all come about?
Yes.
Is that what you're asking me?
I am.
Okay. Yes. All right, so by then, Kill Jackie Jr. season 3, I'm thinking, wow, this is a great hit, and I don't want to be just a background guy with, you know, a couple lines here, a couple lines there. And I'm thinking, like, what can I do without, you know, making it so overt and saying, hey, I got a great idea for my character. It'd be great. Give me, you know, a ton of acting time. So... I was reading a book called Murder Machine and true story of the Roy DeMeo mob.
Yeah.
And I brought it to the attention of the writers. One of the mobsters in this crew, about 5, 6, 7 guys, was gay. And they didn't really give a fuck. I mean, they never rented part. They go, look, we don't give a fuck what you do. Don't. You know, involve it here. Don't fucking come off to anybody. Do what you got to do. And this guy used to cut up people and fucking go with, I guess, robbing cars. They were big car thieves.
Yeah.
And they let him live. They, you know, he, I, so I said, wow, that's kind of interesting. Guy's a mobster and something you never see in a show like this or any mob. I'd be willing to do it, and I'm going to bring it to the attention of writers. So I grabbed Robin Green, one of the writers, and I said, look, how to do it. Grab her alone. No one heard me. I was like, I said, I'm reading this book. And this mobster in this that's gay, and it's kind of interesting. You never see. I'd be willing to do it. And she said, really? Oh, okay. I'll have a look. I didn't hear anything for a year and a half. Until we went back to season 5. And they said, Joe, Paulie Walnuts is going to walk in. You're in the back room. He's going to say, Vito, where the fuck is my Tupperware? And you're going to say, take it easy. My wife's cleaning it. And I said, wow, I got a fucking wife now. I said, oh, okay. So didn't think anything of it. Season 3, episode 2, 3. At that time, one of the actors got drunk and left the script in a cab, and they freaked out. So they stopped giving us our sides, our scripts. Of course, you know, the big people got them. But everyone else, only the scenes that you were in, when we did the read-through, which is where all the actors in that episode read the script. But you only got the scenes you were in to work on. So we all had a mole. And we'd ask them, because the crew got the script because they had to prepare for the next episode. Props and hair and this and that and the other thing. So we'd say, what's going on next episode? Am I getting killed? Am I in it? Is there, you know, I got some good stuff. The guy would be, no, yes, no, you're not getting killed. You're not getting killed. Yeah, you got some stuff. I asked him this one time. I go, what's going on? He goes, oh, you're good. You're good. You got some stuff. I said, oh, okay, great. And I'm walking away. And he goes, oh, I forgot to tell you. You're going to be blowing a guy. And I fucking said, what? And I went, holy fuck, they're doing it. So the first thoughts was my friends are going to break balls like forget. And the second thing about all the wise guys that I know, now they're thinking, hey, this kid's not married. Is he a fucking homo? And me, I never had a problem with the gay thing because I worked in New Orleans. I worked in restaurants. I worked in an all-gay restaurant. Me and this kid, Danny, were only and the chef. All the girls, all the waiters used to bring girls into the kitchen to meet us. You know, I was 175, a good-looking bastard, you know. And I never had a problem with it. I'm a live and let live kind of guy. So I'm thinking all that's going through my head. So I get through the read-through, and Jimmy comes over to me and says, listen, if you don't feel comfortable doing this, you don't have to do it. Like, I'll talk to David. I said, you know, I kind of suggested it. It's not what I had in mind. I'm actually on the wrong end of this blowjob. So that was a big laugh. Anyway, I said, I want to do it.
You didn't know if you were catching or pitching. You didn't know?
No, until I said, you know, I'm fucking blowing a guy. Because, you know, and I said, oh, that sucks. I thought I'd be one of those self-loathing homosexuals where you get piped and then you kick the shit out of the guy because you hate yourself, you hate him.
Right.
I said, I don't want to just do this and then forget about it like the Russian. If I'm going to do it, and they go, well, that's all you're going to see this year, but get ready. Next year is going to be a big year for you. And I can honestly say that scene with the security guard, I was watching with 20 guys. They freaked out. I went with Stern to Vegas. He was talking about it for 5 days, hung out with Artie. That scene changed my life and opened up a ton of doors for me. Now, the whole point of doing that was to show I can act, do something different, you know, not typecast. But it did open doors, a lot of doors, but it was supposed to be for acting.
Do you think, let me ask you, because I'm always fascinated by this. I never, until you told me, I always thought that, you know, I knew about Vito Arena, but I always thought the story was based off John D'Amato.
Yeah, so what happened was, after I gave him the book, and they killed this guy in Jersey for being gay, and they asked me the name of the book, because now it struck home. Now it was Jersey. Now it's the second time. Yeah. Now they kill this guy. So that's what fucking sent it home.
Okay. I understand.
And that's when I said, oh, fuck, they're really thinking about it because of just what happened to the guy. Because I was reading Gangland and everything. I was up on my mob lore. I read all the books. You know, it's my neighborhood. I'm fascinated with it.
Yeah, you always are fascinated, right? Did you ever, was there ever a talk like, did you ever say to David at one point, like, maybe I'll just kill Finn? Because Finn is the only person that's ever seen this.
No. So I didn't say anything. The only thing when I heard that I was going, I went into his office, tried to talk him out of it.
Okay.
And he just let me talk for like 2 minutes, which seemed like 15. And he goes, you're going. And I go, okay. I went from one small scene to my iconic role, the greatest show ever.
Yeah.
39 episodes. I'm okay with it. I wanted to make it to season 6, but, you know.
But you knew that character, there was going to be an end for that because that was not ever going
to Well, they let Vito live, Arena, the other guy they killed. The bottom line is that it was hurting Tony in the pocket. It's always about money. It's always about money.
Do you feel bad what happened to your son?
You know, he was a kid trying to lash out. You know, it's a heavy thing for a kid, you know?
Yeah, you left them with a big pile of shit in their hand, literally. But I want to talk about some of your best work was with John Costello, who played Johnny Cakes.
Yeah.
Let me ask you, when you ate the Johnny Cakes for real, did you actually really enjoy them? Or was that just a pancake?
They actually make, you know, Johnny Cakes are made with white, can you hear me?
White cornmeal, yeah.
White cornmeal. And so they were authentic. They probably weren't hot. You know, I tasted it, but scene after scene after scene, how much you're going to eat, you know, it's always the case. You take a little bite, you chew it for fucking 5 minutes.
It just seemed, you know, like the relationship you had, it was tumultuous at times because you're kind of hiding that you're who you really are. He is such a good actor. And I know you knew him previously, didn't you?
I knew him previously. We ran in the same circles. My friend Tim was friends with him. He directed us in this short film. And I was very happy. He knew I do a big, huge Christmas decoration thing. And I collect Santas. And he gave me a Santa and a leather jacket on a motorcycle, which is one of my prized possessions. I have like over 300 Santas. Yeah.
Wow.
I'm a little OCD. Anyway, John was, you know, he was a favorite of George Ann Walken. And I can't even remember their names. But the gritty New York kind of movies that were out. And he had such a bright future. It's one of those things that you can't understand. And I was in Detroit. I got the call and I go, son of a bitch.
And for anyone that doesn't know what Joe's talking about, John Costello sadly took his own life in 2008, a couple years after the show. And he really was. I know he was in a lot of different things. He was actually a firefighter for real in real life.
In Brooklyn.
In Brooklyn.
Yeah. And Buscemi knew him.
Yeah. That's it's definitely sad. You had told me that. I actually didn't know that until you told me that.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was a great character. I have to ask you, Joe. This is kind of a question that I didn't know if I would ask you or not, but I have to. What was it like kissing him?
Yeah. So we're in that field, right? And it's a long shot. And we're rolling around in the hay. And we gotta lock lips. And the first time I did it, you know, we don't open mouth, fucking tongue. We just smooch. But his mustache, I got it on my, you know. I said, bro, yeah. Listen, we got to get hair and makeup here because I'm getting nauseous with the fucking mustache, man. We got to brush that shit up. And I said, Johnny, look, as soon as they take care of this mustache, let's just fucking do it and get out of here. And that's the only time I think we kissed. But again, you know, you blank your mind, you do it, it's acting, mm-hmm. You just do it. You don't play like, you know, I got to tell you a funny line. I was on stage somewhere and there was a group of people and they asked an actor, what role won't you play? And he say, I'd never play a gay guy. All right. So everybody starts laughing, looking at me, right? I'm pretty sure I invented the mic drop. I said, let me have the mic. And I said, I'd rather suck cock than rat on my friends. And they went nuts. And that's the truth, because you know where you stood with Vito. It is what it is, but he's not going to fucking rat on his friends.
Right. And you got to respect him for that, for sure. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you. So one of the things I bond with my own father over is The Sopranos. I remember people ask me all the time, how did I get into this genre? And I said, I was 10 years old, watched Sopranos. My parents watched it every week. And I told my dad last night that I was interviewing you, and he said, he brought up the scene. I think it's your greatest scene, truly. I still think of it to this day. He mentioned to me yesterday, he was at work, and he did the same thing. The scene where you're in the barn, cutting the wood.
Yeah, checking your watch.
And it's such a – friends of mine and I, we talk about all the time where you're talking about 12 o'clock, got to be. And then you look at the thing, fuck me.
Yeah, I go, you know, that's so many people's favorite scene because they don't want to look. And they look at the angle of the sun. It's got to be 10:30, close to 11. And I think it was 10:10. And I go, and I said, wow, another 12 o'clock, you can eat Jim's sandwiches. It's going to be great. And you go, what the fuck, 10:10? I go, fuck me. That was a great scene. People love it.
Well, you know, some of the people that you worked with, Frank Vincent, Tony Sirico, those guys, you know, were in a lot of mob films. They were in some iconic roles. Phil and you had a very interesting relationship. You were in a lot of scenes with him. What was it like working with Frank Vincent?
So when we were at Allegra's wedding, the movie that really got me into acting, or really I just like became obsessed with, was Raging Bull. Mm-hmm. 1980. I'd come home probably hammered after working in a restaurant. I'd go out. I'd be with a broad. I'd go, you got to watch this movie. Just watch this scene. And it's him at the fucking table. You know, do me a favor. Hit me in the face. You know what I mean? Hit me in the face. She get a little fucking guy. Oh, this guy's a little nuts. I go, you see? So anyway, we're at the table at the, and I go, Frank, that's like my all-time favorite movie. And can I do something? And he goes, hey, whatever you want to do. So I put tissues in my mouth, top and bottom, and I go, hey, Ray, you never got me down, Ray. I'm still standing, Ray. You never got me down. And he goes, you done? Yeah, that was good. I go, all right, I had to do it. Sorry. It was fucking great. I love Frank.
He, I think to this day, he's a super underrated character. Very funny. I mean, just, he was, you know, 20 fucking years, you know, like that's, he has some great one-liners. There's a Twitter account called Phil Leotard. I don't know if you've ever seen it. He only recites quotes that Phil would say. So like, let's say he finds someone does something woke, he'll just respond in only Phil quotes. It's very
funny. Yeah. My Twitter account, X, has been hacked. It's been hacked.
That. I wanted to ask you about that. They're saying a lot of like gay jokes and stuff.
Yeah. Because I was at a party, and I'm pretty sure someone said something stupid. And sometimes I'll just delete it, or sometimes I'll just say, "Go fuck your mother," which is pretty harmless. That's my standard response. Or ask your sister, either one. And I did it with I just had the party. It was an NFL. My friend was like, Joe, bro, what's going on? And people are sending me, and I thought it was like, you know, I get these things. I think your Twitter's hacked and they're trying to get your password and shit like that. Sure enough, I have been. And it's such a fucking pain to get back in that I'm at the point where I don't really give a fuck.
I'm not saying it's funny, but do you think it's kind of funny that they're just pretending to be Vito? Like that's
well, I actually saw some of the things. It was me with an NFL linebacker for the Ravens.
Yeah, it's just kind of fucked up.
And it was actually pretty funny. It wasn't like, hey, I'm sucking fucking the N-words and ox all day and night. You know, it wasn't like nasty shit. Yeah. So it was actually pretty funny. And whatever.
It's kind of playful. But last question I have on Sopranos, and then we'll kind of wrap up. I have some questions on just some other things. Do you think Tony Soprano dies at the end?
No, I always think that. Even if he did, I don't want to believe it. I think that he lived and he went on. And all that tension with Meadow parking the guy walking in, the guy at the counter, the guy going to bathroom, all tension building. Now, I could be wrong, and maybe something did happen, but I think it's very rare for someone to get killed in front of the family.
And we're that's the thing about, that's what I always say.
We're not Colombians.
Yeah, the authenticity would really be shattered if he was killed.
And you don't want to see Tony die. You don't want to see him get arrested. You don't want to see him get dragged in and he flips. He just went on with his life. And that's the way I like to remember him.
Have you ever heard my theory on what I think happened?
I have not.
Well, I'll just tell you it very quickly. It's probable that Tony either dies or goes to prison within the next year or two. That's pretty clear. Carlos flips. He's going away. I believe that current day Soprano family, you know who I think it's run by?
Don't tell me his son.
Yeah.
I don't think he had the moxie.
But let me explain to you why he does. Do you know what the mob's like today? None of them have the moxie, and they're all in control. And remember, Joe, he was working for Carmine in the porn business. Okay, it's not crazy to think he becomes an earner of some sort. He's already indebted to a lot of those guys. They all know him. He doesn't have anything else. Carmine's not a regular guy. He's a mob boss. What do you think he's going to become?
I don't think he had the stature. Like,
but he was a lot more like Tony, Joe, than you think. Remember, he Junior. That's not easy.
But I don't think he was imposing as tough. Don't forget, another guy took over for his father. He wasn't really respected. He was known as a dum-dum. So true. I don't know. You know, maybe it just disbanded. Maybe, I don't know. Good question, but I never really dawned on me that he would be the one to take over.
Yeah, it's definitely a weird theory. You were in Rob the Mob. That's a great mob film. Do you know much about that story? Did you know anything about
it? Yeah. I remember following it. Uva, Rosemary and Tommy Uva. Tommy?
Yeah. Well said.
It's a good idea. You know, you rip off mob games.
Yeah, they're not going to call the police.
Can't call the cops. It's probably just cash.
A lot of people call Tom Uva stupid. I don't. I think he was very smart. He stole from gangsters who were stealing from other people.
Right. It's pretty flawless. I'm surprised it hasn't been copied. I remember that. Uva, UVA.
Yeah, you're well said. Michael, there was actually another one made called The Wannabe. It was the same story. Your co-star's in it, Imperioli. I want to just ask one thing about cooking. Well, actually, two things about cooking. You've always had a love for cooking. You wrote a book about cooking. You've done some TV. You did something with Gordon Ramsay, didn't you?
Nonsense. The thing with Gordon Ramsay, nonsense.
Did you meet him?
Yeah, of course.
How's he?
He was good. He was a fan. But, you know, it's all set up and bullshit and nonsense. Yeah. I was like, what the fuck? But, you know, it paid. It's all setups, reality.
I told you I have your book to this day.
Right. A cookbook novel, which was pretty unique. People love it. I think that's a good story. I'm being worked on now and turning it into some sort of series. I don't want it to be, you know, just cooking and history of food that's boring but done a million times. I want to make it interesting and funny and use clips from movies, which somewhere hopefully down the road we can do. And I wouldn't grow up, you know, a big cooking family with food all over. You know, we were middle class and, you know, you ate one meal. You know, I remember Christmas Eve, St. Joseph's Day, pasta guisade. You know, Italian, like in a bullshit, the pasta con sarde. But we say pasta guisade. Yeah. I had my daughter doing it when she was like 7.
Joe, you're from Napoli, I'm thinking, right?
I'm Abruzzese and a Sicilian. My mother was Sicilian. Magabed.
Gotcha. Well, yeah, I feel like your dialect's very Neapolitan, I felt like.
I don't even know, but I mean, I try to talk like a real gutter fucking thing. Anyway.
Yeah, like that's, I don't know.
Yeah.
But you're working on a lot of things. You got the,
you know what Gita? You know what Gita is?
Gita?
Yeah. No. Get the fuck out of here. Yeah. So anyway, my cooking.
Do you know that guy?
These and those?
These nuts?
Wait. These what?
These nuts?
Oh, these nuts. Yeah.
But no, continue. I'm cutting it.
Yeah. So I'm doing these cooking parties. I did it for a girl that was a friend. She put up on Facebook, and for the last 4 years, it's kind of like blown up. I've did over 100.
Your info's there. If anybody wants Joe to come cook for them, I've actually heard it's very good. I've heard that.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's not for everyone because it's expensive. 16 person minimum. They pay for the food. They pay me. They pay for my assistant. I've had over 100, but it's not cheap. People inquire. They look at the prices. They go, okay, thank you. We'll think about it. They're not thinking about it. They don't have the cash, but that's fine. I'm busy like every almost Friday and Saturday. So it's good. I enjoy it. You just never know what kitchen you're walking into.
Well, I'm going to talk to you off the air because I have an idea that I was thinking about last night. I'm going to pick 20 people and enjoy my show. And at some point, I'm going to put this together and I'm going to have you come and cook for us. I want to do
that. Yeah, if you're in where you are, that's a fucking hike.
No, I'll come to you. We'll do it somewhere in New York.
Okay. Well, I mean, I've had people come in from Maryland. I've had people come in from somewhere else. And I got a veterans hall by me that I've cooked in. They rented out $500 a day, 6 hours. You could smoke cigars at the bar. That'd be fucking fine.
Yeah, I think we're going to do that. We'll have to make that happen. Joe, you got a lot going on. You also have a vodka. A lot of vodkas around nowadays in this space.
Yeah, a lot of vodkas. Mine's just actually today, I just posted it, won another award. It's the fifth gold medal that they won, and a silver. It's made from grapes in Spain. It's called Rocka Vodka. And I got approached by now a good friend. And the vodka is amazing. People like, wow, this is, it's sweet. It's not sweet. It just doesn't have that burn. And I cook with it. I make penne alla Rocka Vodka. But I do mine a little differently. I don't do it, because when you have vodka sauce, you really don't taste the vodka. So I do mine differently, where you definitely taste the vodka. And because it doesn't burn and it's grapes, it gives you a nice taste in your mouth. In your mouth over here.
I love it. Rocka Vodka. That's awesome. Joe, that idea you have for a show sounds interesting. If you ever need a mob historian, you know where I'm at.
We're going to be talking, brother, because I can see consulting. You're very knowledgeable. You're on the money. And you have a wealth of resources to tap into. And that would be fun.
Well, can I tell how we got in touch, you and I? I think it's kind of cool. So
sure.
I was on TikTok the other day, and you had reached out to me and you said, hey, I saw your video. I think it's really cool. And I didn't believe it was you. I said to you, are you the real Joe? And you're like, yeah, it's me. Give me a call. And I thought that was super cool. So TikTok's kind of worked out for me in certain ways. And you said you liked what I was doing. And that was really cool for me because, you're one of my favorites. So
thank you. Scrolling down and I all of a sudden I see my mug pop up and I go, holy shit, he did the one on Vito with, I always forget his name, John Amato?
Yeah,
John Amato.
Your stories are very similar. I don't say that it's based on that, but your stories, what all happened is kind of similar,
Yeah. Yeah.
That was cool. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and here we are. We talked. We got a lot of the same ideas. And I like what you do. It's straightforward. It's not fluffy. It's not bullshit. And it's not long. It's just done right, How long are they? 3 minutes, 2.5 minutes, 4 minutes?
Yeah, TikTok, I try to keep to around 3 minutes.
Yeah, so you get it done, and it's pretty cool.
I appreciate that, Joe. And you've done some great work in your past. You have an awesome story. I never knew that you literally pretended to be a manager and got your first job through that. That's pretty cool. And you've built it. I've always say life is about levels, right? You start one place, but where you start is not where you finish. You move up, and there's levels to this shit. And eventually, you become one of the greatest well-known actors on the best television show of all time. So you've done a lot of cool things.
Thank you. And it's opened a lot of doors for you. People have come to me and go, oh, my kid wants, could you give him some advice? And I go, what I did to get where I am, there's no one going to be doing that.
It ain't going to work for you.
No one's going to fucking do that.
No, I tell people that all the time. They're like, how can I work here and there? And I say, you got to sit here and do shows for nobody for years.
And now you got quite a few followers. I mean, you're up there.
Yeah. And I've, you know, like I said, but I've been doing this since 2009. Like, it doesn't just happen.
Wow.
It takes a long time. So
yeah, it definitely does. And one thing Brooklyn has taught me, because people go, from Brooklyn. Listen, Brooklyn right now is a shithole. But back in the day, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, it was the fucking best.
Yeah.
And for me, it taught me how to hustle, think outside the box, and fucking, I don't stop until I get it. And that's why I have an NFL licensed product. That's how I got my book fucking done. I had one backfire on me, a pull stick, a cue to die for. Didn't go over too much with Glad. I've had my own sauce, which is a waste of time. Now the vodka. They approached me, but I said, look, you have no idea the fucking doors I'm going to open for you as far as distributors, restaurants, places to get me in signed bottles. And it's been like that. The guy's like fucking amazed. So
I think the final thing hustle. I'll say about you is you are always willing to try something, whether it's vodka, a day roll, you know, like you're very, I think, willing. And I think that's allowed you to, like you said, I've heard actors do interviews. I would never play a gay guy. And it's like, well, that's why nobody really knows who the fuck you are.
I don't know if I'd play a rat, because when I was with Stern in Vegas, after that Finn scene, Henry Hill was there and he wanted to take a picture. I go, I'm not taking a picture with you. I'm sorry. I can't. I just can't. You know, this guy's fucking away because you ratted them out. So I'm a loyal guy. And yeah, that's me.
Well,
but my man Jeff, listen, it's been an absolute pleasure. I'm going right to fucking bed.
Yeah, I know you're not feeling well. So I appreciate you coming on, Joe Gannascoli. You're the man. We'll talk soon. Thanks for coming on, man.
I look forward to seeing it and posting it. Be well, brother.
Thanks, Joe. See you.
All right, buddy.
Joe Gannascoli, everybody. That was really awesome. That was a bucket list item for me. If you know me, you know I love The Sopranos. And for me, that interview was super cool, because one of the things that I bomb with my own dad over is the show. We talk all the time about Sopranos. And when I told him I was interviewing Joe, it was fun. It was cool. You know, that's one of the reasons I started and had an interest in this stuff. You know, way back in 1999, I would sit outside of my parents' room and watch the show. So that was really cool. Like, some people, if they're a football reporter, like interviewing Tom Brady is cool. In my world, this is very related to film and entertainment and TV. And Joe's one of those just classic mob actors from a show. So I'm glad I was able to do that. I hope you enjoyed it. I thank you, as always, for watching The Sit Down, listening to The Sit Down. If you enjoy it, just make sure you hit the like button. Tell your friends. Tell people you think might like it. Share it. And go support our people at MyBookie. Promo code SITDOWN. Thanks, as always, for watching. We'll see you next week here on The Sit Down.